Hello, and welcome to a new episode of Constructing Kingdoms with the Violet Howler, a literary analysis of the Kingdom Hearts story. While editing my first batch of videos, I was asked what Donald and Goofy contributed to the story that couldn't be replicated by giving Sora any other characters as traveling companions. And it made me realize that even though they've been a constant presence in the series, I haven't seen a lot of analysis or discussion that specifically talks about the role that the classic Disney trio of Mickey, Donald, and Goofy play within the narrative. At least not in terms of the themes, character archetypes, and storytelling patterns that the series is playing with by casting them as Sora and Riku's sidekicks. So for today's episode, I've decided I'll be taking a deep dive into Mickey, Donald, and Goofy's place in Sora and Riku's journeys, why they were the ones chosen to fill that role, as well as the themes and symbolism conveyed by how they're portrayed in the series. Before we go any further, we should first establish why Sora and Riku's major allies and traveling companions are Disney characters in the first place, rather than Final Fantasy characters, or even brand new ones. From a purely logistical perspective, a lot of it likely has to do with the fact that Kingdom Hearts was specifically created from the collaboration of two different companies. So with the visual designs of the original characters heavily skewing toward the aesthetics associated with Square Enix's Final Fantasy franchise, it makes sense to balance things out by having Sora and Riku's main companions be Disney characters. That way, the art styles of both companies that came together to make this story possible are represented in the main cast. And given that the game is built on the premise of traveling to worlds modeled after Disney properties that teach the heroes lessons on their journeys, it also makes perfect sense for our protagonists to be accompanied by Disney characters as they journey through those worlds. So when it comes to characters that audiences can take one look at and instantly think Disney, you can't get much more recognizable than Mickey Mouse, Donald Duck, and Goofy. The three of them together are the golden trio of Disney mascot characters, and were each pop culture icons in their own right years before the company became famous for their feature-length animated movies. But beyond their status as company mascots and the fact that Disney placed strict limits on how Mickey could be used in the first game, each of their personalities also complement that of the character they're grouped with. Mickey, being known as a cheerful paragon of goodness who's friendly to everyone by default, balances out Riku's tendency to brood over his past sins and be more guarded with his emotions. Because of that contrast, Mickey serves as a consistent source of encouragement and guidance for Riku from the end of Kingdom Hearts 1 all the way through Chain of Memories, which helps Riku deal with his inner turmoil and make meaningful progress on his road to redemption, similar to the relationship between Prince Zuko and his uncle Iroh in Avatar: The Last Airbender. Meanwhile, the differences between Sora and his Disney sidekicks cause them to butt heads with each other early on because of how fundamentally similar they are. Because while Donald in Kingdom Hearts is the one in their group most concerned with following the rules and social expectations that have been laid out for him, like maintaining world order and showing respect for authority figures, he can be just as reckless and impulsive as Sora. Meanwhile, Goofy and Sora are both seen as dumb by the people around them, but are both a lot smarter and more perceptive than others give them credit for. Goofy also serves as a middle ground between Donald and Sora to balance out their contrasting behavior. He follows Donald's lead when it comes to rules and social norms, but he's also willing to follow his heart and act on impulse like Sora when he feels the situation calls for it. We also see Goofy's balancing role reflected in his refusal to pick sides during Donald's and Sora's feud while they're visiting Deep Jungle in Kingdom Hearts 1, as well as his main weapon being a shield instead of something more offensive like Sora's Keyblade or Donald's magic. This dynamic between the three of them is a fairly common one among trios in fiction for all ages. We see it with Aang, Sokka, and Katara in Season 1 of Avatar, Jack, Will, and Elizabeth in the Pirates of the Caribbean films, and Han, Leia, and Luke in the original Star Wars movies. It's a character dynamic that's rooted in Freudian psychology, which believes that the human psyche is divided into three parts: the id, representing our emotions and instincts; the superego, representing logic, self-discipline, and concern for social norms; and the ego, which serves to reconcile the two extremes and keep them balanced. In storytelling, the characters that correspond to the id and superego are typically written as foils to each other. For those unfamiliar with the term, a foil is a character written to contrast with another to better highlight or differentiate certain qualities that the other character has. A foil will normally be written as either the exact opposite of the character they're meant to contrast, or will be similar in some way so that the writers can emphasize their differences. For example, in Big Hero 6, Hiro Hamada and Professor Callahan are both brilliant inventors whose actions for most of the movie are motivated by grief over the loss of a loved one and a desire to make the person responsible suffer. But Hiro manages to make peace with his brother's death through the support of friends and family who help him process his grief. Meanwhile, Callahan isolates himself from anyone who could help him and refuses to move past his grief over his daughter or let go of his quest for vengeance. And in Beauty and the Beast, both Gaston and the Beast are initially rude, prideful, and selfish. But the Beast is willing to recognize when he is in the wrong and puts in the work to improve his behavior, while Gaston continues to believe that he is always right all the way to his bitter end. In Kingdom Hearts, the fact that Donald and Sora are both known for being impulsive, with their biggest difference being Donald's ability to hold himself in check and insist on following existing social expectations, make them clear foils to each other. Because Donald's concern with rules and expectations causes him to disregard anything that doesn't align with his view of the world, like when he dismisses Deep Jungle as unimportant and not worth visiting in Kingdom Hearts 1. But it's Sora following his heart and landing there anyway over Donald's protests in order to look for Riku and Kairi that gives Donald and Goofy their first solid lead on King Mickey's whereabouts. So Sora serves to teach Donald the value of following your heart and acting on impulse without letting social expectations hold you back. And we see later on that Donald clearly took that lesson to heart, as he ultimately chooses Sora over their mission in Kingdom Hearts 1, and later directly defies Mickey's orders to leave when their friends are in trouble during the Battle of Hollow Bastion in Kingdom Hearts 2. But just like how I said in previous videos that a character can have more than one shadow figure, the same is true for foils. Because even though he's already in the middle of their two extremes, Goofy also functions as a foil to Sora as well. Because while both of them are smarter than they get credit for, Sora will still jump into things and go with the flow even when he doesn't understand what's going on, while Goofy will usually take his time and try to think about things before reacting. On top of that, Sora is not the only character that Donald and Goofy are foils to. Because just like how Maleficent was using Riku to further her own plans, Donald and Goofy had ulterior motives for helping Sora in Kingdom Hearts 1. The whole reason that they even let him come on the gummy ship with them in the beginning was because King Mickey told them to stick with the person who had the key. And once that key changes hands, they only hesitate for a moment before leaving Sora to fend for himself right at the doorstep of enemy territory. Much like how Maleficent shows no concern for Riku or his well-being once he gets possessed by Xehanort's Heartless and she has all seven princesses of heart. Which makes it pretty ironic that our villain consistently honored the deals that Riku made with her in exchange for his help, while Donald at first didn't care whether they found Sora's friends at all and just made empty promises to get him on the gummy ship. Because as soon as Sora tries to actually look for his friends in a place that seemingly had no relevance to their search for Mickey, Donald outright told Sora that his mission was more important. Then when Sora was finally reunited with one of those friends, Donald flat out prohibited Riku from coming on the gummy ship with them. And although we never hear Goofy agree with Donald's behavior, we never hear him explicitly disagree either. Even when Goofy expresses reservations about leaving Sora after Riku takes the Keyblade in Hollow Bastion, he still goes with Donald and Riku when push comes to shove. So in Kingdom Hearts 1, the Disney characters that Sora and Riku each end up with after their islands fall to darkness are ultimately using them for their own agendas. But over time, each of those Disney characters grows to genuinely care about them. While Riku is understandably skeptical when Maleficent says that he's like a son to her, the Kingdom Hearts 2 novel indicates that she actually meant it by describing how even though she was using him, she still felt hurt that he ditched her after Kingdom Hearts 1. And as we know, Donald and Goofy grew to care about Sora so much that when they were forced to choose between their mission and his life, they ultimately choose him. From which point, they continue to spend time with Sora and aid him on his journey because they want to, rather than because they need something from him. Which contrasts how Maleficent never seeks Riku out herself after her return in Kingdom Hearts 2 because there wasn't anything in her current plans that she needed him for like in Kingdom Hearts 1. And both relationships also contrast with King Mickey's relationship to Riku. Because unlike the ulterior motives of Maleficent, Donald, and Goofy, Mickey Mouse has consistently tried to help Riku without any hidden strings or agendas attached. He wants to help and guide Riku for the sake of it, rather than because of Riku's usefulness. Even though he needed Riku's help to close the door to darkness in Kingdom Hearts 1, he didn't frame it as something he specifically needed Riku for. He just described it as something that needed more than one person when Riku specifically asked for advice on what he should do next after he ended up in the Dark World. Even after that was completed, he chose to stick around and follow Riku anyway, unlike how Maleficent has made no effort to stay in contact with Riku now that she doesn't need him at the moment. So on top of being foils to Sora, Donald and Goofy are also foils to Maleficent and King Mickey. Yet that still leaves the question of what purpose these four being foils to each other serves in the context of the franchise's overall narrative. But because Donald, Goofy, Mickey, and Maleficent are all foils to each other, we can piece together the messages and themes that the story is trying to communicate by comparing their relationships with Sora and Riku, respectively. While Ansem the Wise and Xehanort's Heartless both play a role in trying to shape the direction of Riku's journey, Mickey and Maleficent are the ones who provide Riku with the direct support and guidance that shapes the course of his character arc. Maleficent provides Riku with information, offers him advice, and teaches him new skills throughout Kingdom Hearts 1. And his interactions with her doppelganger in Chain of Memories inspire his initial goal of fighting his way through all the villains in the card world to symbolically conquer his darkness. Riku is never shown learning any new skills from King Mickey during any of the times they've been on screen together, and only received exposition that would help his goals like the kind Maleficent gave him once at most near the end of the first game. But the advice and encouragement Mickey offers is a critical source of emotional support while Riku struggles with his inner darkness in Chain of Memories. And although Mickey usually respects Riku's desire to handle situations on his own, he's always willing to jump in and help when he feels that Riku needs it. Similarly, Donald and Goofy only really teach Sora some basic skills like how to cast magic or use abilities like dodge roll as part of the first game's tutorial portion. But once they choose him over their mission, they start providing advice, encouragement, and both physical and emotional support during his journey, just like Mickey does with Riku. They try to offer comfort and encouragement when he's feeling down, give him advice to try and deal with his problems, and try to keep him out of trouble, either by encouraging him to think before rushing into things, or making sure he doesn't go into dangerous situations alone if they can't keep him out of it. Even when Sora gets mad at them and runs off on his own in Chain of Memories, they still follow him to make sure he's safe and jump in to protect him when people try to hurt him. So with Maleficent being a clear example of the evil mentor archetype, Mickey, Donald, and Goofy play the role of more conventional, non-evil mentors to Riku and Sora on the two boys' respective journeys. And in coming-of-age narratives, it's common for mentors and older allies to be portrayed as parents for the protagonists, regardless of whether they have a positive, negative, or no relationship with their birth parents. Maleficent identifying herself as a parental figure to Riku logically frames her relationship with him as that of a controlling, toxic, or outright abusive parent, like the fairy tale trope of the wicked stepmother that I touched on her being an embodiment of in my previous video. And given that Mickey is portrayed as a positive influence to Riku in contrast with Maleficent being a negative one, her being a bad parent means that it's logical to conclude that the king must be an example of a good parent. This is even supported by the Chain of Memories novel, where Riku says that he doesn't have anyone when Pinocchio asks if he has a father, only for him to be reminded that he's not going through his ordeal alone, with the novel specifically emphasizing his connection to Mickey. And if Mickey's guidance and support is used by official material to frame him as one of Riku's parents, then Donald and Goofy providing similar forms of guidance and support logically makes them parents to Sora. Especially because their relationship with Sora parallels the bond that Bagheera and Baloo have with Mowgli in the Jungle Book. Because Bagheera and Donald are both actively focused on cultural norms, as well as the practicality and logistics of their charge's safety, while Goofy and Baloo are more adept at the emotional elements of their respective guardianships and less concerned about rules or social expectations. So even though Sora refers to Goofy as sounding like an older brother in the character files, his and Donald's behavior throughout the series matches up with many of the things that parents are supposed to do. And there's precedent for that because it's not unheard of, in fiction or real life, to have someone you see as a sibling fulfill the responsibilities and expectations of a parent in your life. For example, a major plot point in the Pixar movie Onward involves Ian Lightfoot realizing that his brother Barley stepped in to fill the void left by their father's death and do all the things for Ian that a father was supposed to do, which the director specifically based on his own childhood. Meanwhile, in Avatar, Sokka admits that he can't even remember his mother's face because whenever he tries to think of what she was like, he can only picture his sister Katara. The framing of Mickey, Donald, and Goofy as parents is further enhanced when you take into account that this is not the first time that any of these characters have been depicted being responsible for taking care of and/or raising children. Mickey plays the part of family man Bob Cratchit in Disney's A Christmas Carol short, and has been tasked with watching over his two nephews in many portrayals over the decades. Meanwhile, countless comics, shows, and shorts feature Donald Duck as the main caretaker of his own nephews. And Goofy had an entire TV show built around the concept of him being a single father, with two sequel movies that revolved around him dealing with his child growing up and becoming more independent. Even Maleficent has been portrayed as a parent in recent Disney-affiliated media, both positively in things like Once Upon a Time and the live-action Maleficent movies, and negatively in examples like the Disney Channel movie Descendants. With all of them being foils, Mickey being the paragon of good parenting and Maleficent representing the extremes of bad parenting serve as guideposts for Donald and Goofy's character growth. Because it's common for coming-of-age stories to feature parents whose flaws are a major source of conflict in the narrative that they must confront and overcome in order to grow and have a better relationship with their child. And as I've touched on in multiple previous videos, Donald and Goofy have been major contributors to Sora's insecurities and low self-esteem. Their efforts to cheer him up when the three of them first join forces end up discouraging him from expressing and working through his negative emotions by communicating that his sadness is a burden that will get in the way of reuniting with his friends. Similar to how Riley's mother from Inside Out encourages Riley to stay happy for her father's sake, causing Riley to bottle up her sadness and other negative emotions over moving away from their old home, which leads to her trying to run away after emotionally shutting down. And we saw in Kingdom Hearts 3 how what Donald and Goofy viewed as friendly banter and good-natured teasing exacerbated Sora's deteriorating confidence and sense of self-worth. Furthermore, their constant desire to protect Sora and not let him face things alone contributes to Sora's feelings that he doesn't have the strength or competency to accomplish anything by himself. And their focus on needing his Keyblade in the first game sent the message that Sora was only valued because of what he could do for others. Just like Riley's parents, Donald and Goofy didn't mean to send any of the messages they did, but their failure to notice how their words have affected Sora demonstrates a fundamental lack of understanding of their surrogate child's needs. Which contrasts how Mickey gives Riku whatever support he needs without trying to make him conform to Mickey's expectations or preconceptions about the world. Because when compared with Donald and Goofy's obliviousness to Sora's feelings, Mickey demonstrates a deeper understanding of Riku's needs and motivations after all the time they've spent together. To the point where in Kingdom Hearts 3, he figures out the reason why Riku feels invincible when they're in the Realm of Darkness before Riku himself does. But by demonstrating a superior understanding of his surrogate child, Mickey serves as an ideal of good parenting for Donald and Goofy to strive toward, and provides a model for how they can improve, contrasting how Maleficent represents the warning signs of what not to do. And the queer subtext of both Sora and Riku's journeys that I talked about in Constructing Kingdoms Episode 9 adds further layers to this. Because as I said in that same video, Riku's struggle with darkness can be read as an allegory for a queer teenager coming to terms with their feelings. So Mickey changing his opinion about darkness after spending time with Riku can represent parents who work to unlearn the prejudices they've been taught about queerness so that they can maintain a positive relationship with their child. Meanwhile, Sora, despite being surrounded by straight couples, is still confused about what romantic love is, which I mentioned in Episode 9 is a common experience for queer kids who have no exposure to the idea that attraction to someone of the same gender is even an option. And Sora's confusion is not helped by the fact that there have been multiple times where Donald and Goofy have made teasing comments about Sora that took it as a given that he's attracted to girls. In Chain of Memories, they treated Sora asking Naminé to smile for him as a sappy romantic gesture simply because she was a girl, acting as if this was something he did with every girl he met, when he had never done anything like that with anyone before or since. And in Kingdom Hearts 2, they are the ones who assume Sora was thinking of Kairi when he reflects on what he learned when visiting Halloween Town for the second time. Even though in Japanese, he never used any pronouns to indicate who Jack and Sally remind him of, and the actual message of that section ties into his desire to find Riku. They also tease Sora for blushing at the sight of Elizabeth and Will hugging when they're reunited, insinuating that he's imagining his own romantic reunion hug, and their other comments make it logical to conclude that Kairi is the one they assume he's thinking about. Their behavior is an example of what's known as heteronormativity, a cultural attitude that views heterosexuality and the desire for a romantic relationship with someone of the opposite gender as the universal baseline of normal human behavior. There's more to it that I can't fully cover without getting off track from today's topic, but it can be found in every aspect of society, from government legislation and school policies, to the ways that people talk about romance or attraction for both real people and fictional characters, even the outfits that clothing companies consider acceptable attire for babies. It's something that the Disney Company is particularly infamous for, given the number of times that employees of the film and TV studios they own have called out corporate leadership for trying to water down or completely block attempts to portray non-straight characters in a project. But just as times are changing to the point where creators of Disney-owned properties have been able to successfully portray canon queer characters in spite of any corporate opposition, Donald and Goofy have shown signs that they've grown past their early heteronormativity. Because since the end of Kingdom Hearts 2, they have not made a single comment about Sora's relationships with girls like they did in those early games. Instead, the only times in later titles that they make that kind of joking Sora's got a crush type comment are about Sora and Riku. When Sora sees the Verum Rex box art of Yozora in Kingdom Hearts 3, he comments that he never looks this good, but recognizes the similarities in his and Yozora's outfits. The word he uses in Japanese, kakoyoku, literally means good-looking, but can also be translated as handsome, attractive, stylish, and other words to positively describe a person's physical appearance. In the original Japanese version of this scene, Goofy then says that Yozora resembles Riku more, and then Donald follows up with a comment that can be translated as, "Yeah, he's good-looking." And later in the game, they directly comment on how Sora listens when Riku tells him to stay and focus on his own task while Riku and Mickey go to the Realm of Darkness, but brushes off the same message when it comes from others like Master Yensid. While they've still got a long way to go toward recognizing and repairing the damage their lack of awareness of his mental state has done, their jokes about Sora's feelings for Riku show that they're starting to understand him better in at least this one area. And it also shows that they don't have to change their behavior that much to follow Mickey's example when it comes to their surrogate son's love life. Because the fact that they pivot so easily from teasing Sora because they assume he has a crush on a girl, to teasing him because they can see and hear from their own observations that he has a crush on a boy, demonstrates that they don't have any objection to Sora being queer. They just fell into the heteronormative trap of treating everyone you meet as straight until proven otherwise. So by recognizing where Sora's true feelings are and shifting their behavior accordingly, Donald and Goofy can represent parents who are generally accepting of queer people, but who fail to consider the possibility that their own child might be one due to ingrained cultural blind spots. Both of these relationships serve as positive contrasts with Maleficent's relationship to Riku, because as I said in my previous video, her manipulating him in Kingdom Hearts 1 has left a psychological roadblock in his and Sora's relationship. And in order for them to be ready to get together, that lingering baggage I talked about her representing needs to be cleared up. So Maleficent's manipulation of Riku into rejecting Sora can be viewed as a symbol of parents whose reaction to their kid being queer is to force them into the closet while trying to force them to hide their queerness and conform to heteronormative standards of acceptable behavior. Thus, when examined through a queer lens, Mickey's portrayal as the good parent to be emulated and Maleficent as the bad parenting to be avoided also specifically reflects how Donald and Goofy's parenting could be better or worse in relation to Sora's queerness. And all of this fits incredibly well with the themes of each heroine's journey framework that the Disney trio's surrogate children are following on their individual stories. Because Mickey's role as the paragon of good parenting for others to emulate works perfectly with how his encouragement of Riku in Chain of Memories lines up with the support stage on Victoria Schmidt's version of the heroine's journey. Meanwhile, in Murdoch's version that Sora's character arc has been following so far, the allies that the protagonist gathers in the early stages of their journey often represent the cultural expectations that the protagonist is living under. Like how in Voltron Legendary Defender, Princess Allura's own allies try to hold her back from taking risks in everything from acquiring knowledge to directly participating in the war against the Galra Empire. Because as I've said in previous videos, Maureen Murdoch's model for the heroine's journey was crafted to help a demographic whose experiences Murdoch felt were overlooked by society, and therefore social commentary is woven into the central conflict. So Donald and Goofy discouraging Sora from dealing with his own pain because they need him for his Keyblade reflects the same criticism of toxic positivity that Inside Out does, but at the same time, it also reflects the same needs-of-the-many attitude that generations of Keyblade Masters have been holding to going as far back as the Age of Fairy Tales. And while the narrative doesn't explicitly frame it this way, the visual of a teenage boy being told to hide his pain resembles the common attitude about masculinity that considers it weak for a man to show emotional vulnerability in front of others. Which is something I plan to go into more detail on in my next season because those kinds of gender expectations are such a big part of the heroine's journey that it needs its own video. Meanwhile, the queer reading of Sora's journey turns Donald and Goofy's comments about Sora and girls that I talked about a few minutes ago into a representation of the audience's own collective heteronormative biases. Because like I touched on in episode 9, romance in a heroine's journey is expected to challenge the audience's preconceptions of what people who share aspects of the protagonist's identity should aspire to romantically. So by teasing Sora because of their belief that he's attracted to girls, Donald and Goofy represent the assumption that Kingdom Hearts being a Disney story automatically means that Sora is straight. Which would make Mickey a symbol of people who react positively to their heteronormative expectations being challenged, and Maleficent a symbol of people who react negatively. So in the grand scheme of the Kingdom Hearts narrative, Mickey, Donald, and Goofy occupy the role of surrogate parents to Riku and Sora, and were chosen due to the combination of their status as Disney mascots and the compatibility of their personalities. As individuals, Donald and Goofy each represent an aspect of Sora's character that has been tempered by the social norms he's expected to conform to in the early steps of the heroine's journey. And as a duo, they serve as mouthpieces through which the narrative presents those norms to be deconstructed. As a result, their shared character arc embodies the archetype of the parents whose flaws and mistakes help further the story's conflict until they learn to grow past and confront those flaws in order to have a better relationship with their child. Meanwhile, Mickey serves as a metaphorical angel on Riku's shoulder to contrast Maleficent's toxic influence. Together, Riku's two parental figures function as role models and cautionary tales respectively for Donald and Goofy's character development. each holding up a mirror so we can compare how much Donald and Goofy have grown in their performance as Sora's parents, as well as how much more room they have to improve. And given that the Kingdom Hearts 4 trailer appears to show Donald and Goofy on their own quest to try and get Sora back, the series now has the perfect opportunity to have them reflect on how they've treated him over the years, so they can start doing better when they finally see him again. Thank you all so much for watching. If you have any thoughts, observations, or counterarguments about anything I've said here in this video, feel free to share in the comments below. And if you want to be notified whenever I post more literary dissections of the Kingdom Hearts narrative, feel free to click subscribe, and I'll see you back here again on March 25th for my next video.